Hey, Spencer Payne here with Becker and another edition of Cool Careers in Accounting. I'm here today with Laura Thompson, CPA and CFO. Laura, can you just help, like, rather than me introduce you, can you just tell the audience, to your friends and family, what is it that you say that you do in your work? How do you describe yourself?
Yeah, absolutely, Spencer. Thank you so much for having me. And like Spencer said, my name's Laura Thompson. I'm a CPA, and I'm currently serving as the Chief Financial Officer and Chief Compliance Officer of a private equity firm based here in Houston, where I'm located. And so depending on who I'm talking to, if they are financially sophisticated, I might tell them I'm a CFO. But others, if you say CFO, they might have no idea what that is. And so to other people, I just say, oh, I'm an accountant, and I leave it there. A lot of people may know what private equity is, but definitely others don't. And so sometimes I'll just explain, I work for an investment company. We invest money on behalf of institutions and individuals to try to drive shareholder returns back to our investors. So it really depends on how detailed I am, or maybe the sophistication of my audience, I would say.
Yep, perfect. And when you say you're an accountant, how many of them ask you about taxes?
Everyone.
There you go. That's the assumption.
Everyone. In fact, I am fairly certain that my grandparents still think that I do taxes. And, and you know, to their credit, I do help my mom with her taxes, and I help several family members with their taxes. And so there you go. They're not completely wrong.
They're not completely wrong, but it is so much more than that.
Exactly. Everyone thinks accounting, tax. Actually, I didn't specialize in tax, but there you go.
But you can still do it. And how do you know in this role that you're in now, how do you know you're doing your job well? Like, what if anything can you share around, you know, it's at the end of the year, I did great this year. Like, how do you kind of have a gauge for that? How do you know?
Yeah, it's a great question. I feel like there are so many different metrics that I look at. I mean, one would be just kind of where our performance is as a firm. Now, of course, that's not just solely driven by myself. And we have about 20 individuals at the fund level that manage about 20 active investments. And so, you know, one metric that I look at is, what are our returns for the year? Were we able to deliver liquidity back to our investors? Were, you know, what about the taxable impact to our investors' holdings? I mean, is that, you know, were we able to do things in a tax efficient manner? I also look at how I'm tracking against all my budgets. And so am I keeping a tight eye on expenses, but making sure that we are not so restrictive in our spending that we're avoiding investing in things that can drive a return in the future. Also, for me, probably just being a very type A individual, I'm always looking at my to-do list. And the more things I have crossed off my to-do list usually makes me feel like I'm getting where I need to be and accomplishing everything that my bosses would like me to accomplish, and ultimately making their life easier. So that's just some things that I kind of look at to see really how I'm tracking for the year.
Yep. Awesome. And is there anything over the next, say, 12 months? Are there any specific projects or new systems, or is there anything that you maybe are looking forward to over the next 12 months that's an interesting, new, exciting challenge to tackle in your work? Is there anything you're looking forward to?
Yeah, absolutely. It's funny because I think with accounting, you know, a lot of people assume maybe it's sleepy and you're just doing the same thing every month or every week or every quarter. And my experience cannot be more different from that. And I think every summer that things will slow down and I'm going to catch up on just like prep for, you know, for the next quarter or year end and things like that. And inevitably, there's always some sort of special project going on, whether we're, you know, going through a merger, or raising a new fund, or et cetera, et cetera. And so we are in the process of raising capital at the firm that I'm working at. And this is the first capital raise that we've done since I've joined the firm. And
okay.
So It's kind of an exciting new activity and, you know, just project for me to work on that's different than what I do on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah. And is this the first time you're going through that experience, not just at this firm, but in your career?
It is.
See, there's all kinds of new stuff that happens later in your career, everybody. All kinds of
exactly.
new stuff.
Exactly.
awesome. That's exciting. And like, So now you're a CFO of this firm. You're about to go through this big new project, a capital raise. There's not very many things that are a bigger deal than that. What can you help us understand your path to get to this point? Like, where did you start your career in accounting? What are some of the roles that you took? Maybe some of the skills that you developed? Like, basically, what's the short version? And maybe we can deep dive where there's some really interesting stories of like, how did you get to this role?
Yeah, absolutely. So I would say probably where I started was I was always pretty decent with numbers and pretty good at math. And the story cracks me up now as an adult knowing this, but one of my parents' first parent-teacher conference when I was in elementary school, my teacher told my parents that Laura does math like a boy and she's really good at math.
Yeah.
And you say that,
it was intended to be a compliment. Yeah.
Right. It was a compliment. And my father being a banker, oh, yes, I get that, you know, and my mom being a teacher. So very kind of this, you know, traditional, stereotypical gender roles. And so from a young age, my dad always was pushing me more towards the business path. You know, you should do accounting. People that understand accounting understand the language of business. And so if you, let's say you don't actually want to spend your career in accounting, anything in business, it will be very beneficial to have an accounting degree because you can look at a set of financials and dissect a company and understand what's driving your profit, what's driving your fade, how can we make the business more profitable? And so with that advice, I kind of set off and got my undergraduate degree in accounting and finance, and then got my master's in accounting, set for my CPA, and then did what I think almost all people or all accounting majors did 20 years ago was you went and worked for a big four public accounting firm. I did that for almost 10 years. And really from the beginning, even in my internship with one of the big four firms, I didn't feel like it was my forever home. And I knew that all along, but you know, life has a way of going by quickly. And when you work with good people and you work for good clients and you're constantly learning and being challenged, the years go really fast. And so I stay there a lot longer than I ever would have anticipated. And eventually when I decided that I was ready to make a move out, I just started talking to my network and just saying, you know, old bosses or current clients, just, hey, if you know anyone, I'm looking to make a move, but I've spent almost 10 years here. And so I want to be very strategic in what I'm leaving to do. And yeah. So that's.
And two quick follow-ups to that. So one is about 10 years in, it's finally time. Like,
yeah.
What made it be time?
Yeah.
And second question is, where did you go as your next role? And how did you know that was the right fit? What made you say yes to that particular role that you said yes to?
Yeah, absolutely. Those are great questions. I would say to your first question on how did I know it was time? You know, life has a funny way of, you know, there's different seasons in life and different, you know, different challenges and different successes. And I would say in my early to mid 30s, I lost my brother. My younger brother passed in an unexpected accident. And while it was a tragic situation at the time, it gave me the takeaway of, you know, life is really short and don't take every day for granted. And, you know, although we all know that, and, you know, if you ask anyone, you know, they're going to say, of course, don't take life for granted. Like every day is precious, right? But life just has a way of moving and going. And sometimes it takes something huge to really make you stop and reassess and say, okay, what am I doing with my life? Am I happy? Is this where I'm supposed to be? Is this the greatest, you know, use of my talents and things like that? And so it was the positive from all of that was that I really kind of did a very introspective deep dive on what I was doing with my life and what I wanted the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years to look like. And so that's when I kind of said, okay, I think I'm gonna try something else. Feels like now's the time. So, yeah. And then your second question.
Yeah. What did you say yes to? And why? Like, what were the reasons why you said yes to the move that you made next?
Absolutely. So in accounting, I was, you know, many accountants will start their career in Big Four, and then they go on, depending on how much tenure you have when you leave or how many years you stay in Big Four, you know, you can leave for all sorts of different levels of accounting jobs. And my fear was always to go into a role when I left Big Four and be, you know, booking AP and, you know, just doing like a, you know, just stuck in reconciliation land and just kind of doing like the same thing over and over and being one of many, many, you know, people in an accounting group and just feeling like I was just a number in a big accounting group. And there's certainly nothing wrong with that at all.
It wasn't your path, right?
It just wasn't my path. It just wasn't something that really excited me and motivated me. And so, which is also probably why I had a hard time finding what I wanted to do next, because I wanted something that was a little bit different and that I was going to be really challenged and work with really smart people. And so I ended up getting connected to the firm that I'm at through one of my clients when I was at Big Four.
Okay.
They knew the founders of my firm, and the firm had a part-time CFO at the time, but they had grown so much. They had had just really taken off in growth. And so the CFO that was part-time was really working more than full-time. And so they, you know, they made the decision, like, we need to bring someone in full-time, really to help her out. And eventually she was wanting to retire. And so, you know, kind of bring in someone to grow into the CFO.
So am I to understand this correctly? And correct me if I'm wrong here, 10 years in Big Four, it's time to move on. And your next move is to the place where you are now with the intention of kind of, you are the heir apparent to being the CFO.
Like, yes.
That's pretty fantastic. Exciting. How in the world did you get connected to that as your first role? Hey, congratulations, heir apparent to the CFO. How did you hear about this? How did this become your first yes out of Big Four?
Yeah, well, thank you. I had the same thought. I said, my client CFO brought the role to me and said, hey, I know these guys are looking for a CFO. And I said, I can't be a CFO. And he said, sure you can, you know, like, why not? Right. And I said, I'm not experienced. You know, I mean, yeah, I've worked in audit for almost 10 years, but I've never actually closed the books. I review people closing the books. I've never actually, you know, reconciled the bank statement. Like, I review what my clients, you know, I just had all this thoughts in my head. And my client said, just go talk to him. What's the harm in going to talk to him? And so I did. And, you know, sometimes you just meet with people and you just sense the energy and the intelligence and the drive and the grit. And the founders that I work for, young, gritty guys that are really hard workers, very smart. And meeting with them was just, it really felt like, oh, okay, this is somewhere I could be.
Yeah.
I would be challenged. I would be able to grow into this role. It also helped that Houston is such a small big city, because I was able to do some background checking on different, you know, on people at the firm. And we had some enough mutual connections that I could really do my diligence and make sure I wasn't just seeing something in the interview that maybe wasn't actually going to be the culture 100% of the time.
Yep. So you had to do your vetting process to make sure what they were selling was what was going to be reality, right? Which can be a challenging thing because you haven't done that in 10 years, right? Like, that's a new thing to have to go figure out how to do.
Exactly. And so, yeah, there was a lot of that. And, you know, I met with them several times. I met with the then CFO several times, you know, lots of vetting. And I asked her, you know, I was a little bit nervous about going into private equity. It's a very male dominated industry, particularly on the investment side. And yeah, I was concerned, are they going to, will they have a level of respect for a female, for someone that's younger, et cetera, et cetera. And everything that I was told was absolutely, they're actually really good people and good guys to work for. And, you know, at some point I just kind of had to take people's word for it. And I jumped in, and I am very pleased to say that that was all correct and true. So yeah. I lucked out, but it's been great.
Well, kudos for asking the hard questions like that. Because if you're making a move, right, you need to ask the hard questions to make sure this thing that you're moving to is what you think it's going to be. I'd love to dive deeper on one thing, if you don't mind. Because again, this is going from 10 years in to CFO heir apparent, right? And you mentioned earlier thinking like, can I really do that? Can I make that jump? Am I qualified to do this?
Yeah.
Can you help us all understand how did you get past that, right? There's a lot of people who can think, am I really good enough to do this? Am I the right person? Do I have the skill set? Am I capable? Again, I think a lot of us, I've had those same doubts about myself in certain roles. Can you just share maybe some insights of how did you get past that? How did you get to the other side of that to really see that, like, yes, I can do this and I can be great and I can deliver great results for this team? How did you get to that, the other side?
Great question. I would say that really the main thing is just working really hard and being dedicated. It sounds a little cheesy, but you know, anytime you start at a new job, even if the people might know you, or you might have maybe you crossed career paths earlier in life, or maybe there's a personal connection, you still have to really rebuild that trust bank.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I would say particularly for the first year, it was just really putting my head down, making sure that I was understanding what my boss's expectations were for me, and if I was meeting those, or what I needed to improve on, or if I wasn't meeting his expectations, and really just kind of putting my head down and working hard.
Yeah.
And I know that doesn't sound like the most exciting answer, but yeah,
that solves a lot of problems.
It does.
Working hard so you understand something, and so you're showing also the people around you that you're willing to put in what it requires to make sure that you can deliver well goes a really long way.
Absolutely.
Awesome. And one more quick question on this. What if anything in your 10 years in Big Four, what are some, maybe there's only one biggest one you want to highlight? What's one or maybe a couple of maybe skill sets or things that you learned that you feel were most put you in position to be able to not only go get this next job, but to have stayed there and risen to CFO and kind of continued to rise? Like what was critical that you learned or that you put into practice to put you into that position to be able to take that role?
Absolutely. I think there's two big things that come to mind. The first one is really just the power of relationships. I think that people often underestimate the power of relationships. And I have no doubt that I am where I am because someone believed in me and someone was willing to put my name forward, or even back when I was at Big Four and I worked for the same partner for most of my time there, and I moved around to his different clients, and it was him believing in me and so many other people. And I think we often, or at least in my world, I think there's a temptation to put your head down, get a lot of work done, work really hard. Yes, of course, that's very, very important, but also just maintaining your relationships, because you never know where one person's going to end up and where your journeys might cross paths in the future. So I think that is one thing. The other big thing that I learned in Big Four was just project management, having the ability to keep a team underneath you moving through projects and deadlines and milestones, but being able to just kind of continue to make things happen, to meet your deadlines, to keep deliverables pushing and working on large clients. I think that was certainly a very, very important skill that I do all the time now, although it looks different from every job to job, but just being able to project manage, have your lists, tick through your lists, delegate where you need to delegate, because none of us have endless hours. And so that's very important as well.
Yep, 100%. And do you, one thing that is always a topic people want to hear about and hear how others face is this work-life balance concept. And can we'll just ask directly, right? Do you generally enjoy your work, have a good balance between work and the things that you want to do personally? And maybe also, how has that trended over time? If you don't mind sharing, because sometimes I know for me and for many others, there's times where it's just like, it's grind mode. It is work mode. That is priority. And that's what has to happen for 3 months or 6 months or a year or whatever, whatever it may be. And then things can ease up a bit. And then people kind of can find this balance. And sometimes it's a bit of a roller coaster of how that trends over time. So curious to hear your thoughts on how is that balance for you today? And maybe how has that trended over time? Could you speak to that for others so they can kind of help learn from your experience?
Absolutely. So on work-life balance, it's interesting because things have changed a lot from the time that we started working, and the world has just continued to get more and more interconnected. And it's interesting, when I started my career, we had emails on phones, but it wasn't like today where we have iPhone. Maybe we had iPhones, but we certainly have Blackberries. And I remember, I think I was a second year, and I only had my personal email on my phone. And one of my bosses started emailing my personal email on the weekends. And I thought, I guess he's trying to tell me something.
Yeah, like, how did you get this?
I know. I was like, oh gosh, it feels so invaded, you know? And so that was about the time that I said, well, I guess I better get a BlackBerry. And so, like so many of us did a long time ago, you know, I had the iPhone for my personal, and then I had the BlackBerry with my work email. But the great thing about having two devices is, if I had a day on the weekend where I didn't want to check email or I didn't want to hear it bing at me, I could put it in my closet. And I really would. I would put my BlackBerry in my closet sometimes and just say, you know what? Not today. I'm not checking emails this afternoon. You know, nothing will be that urgent that you can't call me, or it'll be fine. We're not saving lives here, you know? And so as things have evolved, you know, there's pros and cons to it, right? There are very few places in the world that you can go where you don't have access to Wi-Fi and all of the things, which in a way is wonderful, because I can go spend a couple of weeks in Colorado and work from Colorado. But at the same time, going on a European vacation no longer means that I'm actually going to be out of the office for 2 weeks. You know what I mean? Which again, there's pros and cons, right? You can continue to keep up with things, but not be physically in the office. But at the same time, it's usually always there. And so I think, you know, one concept that I heard when I was in Big Four was not so much that we should focus on work-life balance, but more on work-life integration. And so kind of figuring out for every individual, like, how can you make work and life work together and keep your sanity? And so, you know, for me, work-life balance, I don't have children. And so a lot of times it is that, you know, I might stay at the office a little bit later than some of my coworkers who want to get home and, you know, have mealtime with their little ones and get them put in bed. And then they might work, you know, later at night. Whereas for me, that's not really how I work-life balance. But, you know, I think it's always one of those things where you're constantly trying to figure out how to balance it and what works best for you. And it changes in different stages of your life. So
it sure does. And also, like, frankly, there's times where, I mean, I'll admit, right? Like, the thought of turning everything off for 2 weeks maybe isn't actually what I want to do. Because there are certain things that I do that are fun, that I want to go think about. It's more, I don't know, for me as an example, it's more like, oh, perfect. That means I don't have to attend those meetings I don't want to attend. Right. But what exactly. I get to do, because I still want to go get a coffee and spend 90 minutes thinking about something, is I still get to go proactively think about maybe those things that I actually don't have enough time to think about. And now I do. So anyway, there's the point being is there's many ways to think about work-life balance. It doesn't necessarily have to mean, oh, I stop working every day for 2 weeks. It might mean, hey, actually now I get to think about the things that I really proactively want to do that I sometimes don't have the time to think about.
Absolutely. So
there's a million ways to do it.
Absolutely. And I'm a bit of the same mindset. I always have my computer with me when I'm traveling, even if I don't intend on doing any work. But just for me, I enjoy my job. I love my job. And so even just having
That's fantastic. That's even better than the work-life balance question. Like, let's dig into that. Like, what do you love about your job? What has attracted you? What makes you say that? What makes you so excited about your job? What do you love about it?
You know, it's challenging. It's everything. It's always changing. We are industry agnostic. And so we invest in service-based fintech companies. We invest in staffing businesses. We invest in industrial services, you know, all across the board. And so there is always a new type of company that we're diligencing or that we invest in. And it's always different and it's always exciting. And then trying to figure out how do we appropriately value that company? You know, what are the different metrics? Like just all of that is really fascinating to me. And in private equity, just the businesses that we invest in, just depending on what happens with the market and interest rates and, you know, of course, we've been through a wild couple of years with COVID and then, you know, just international disruptions and Ukraine and Russia and, you know, all of that. It's like, well, I never would have imagined all these different things, and they all impact our companies in different ways and some more than others. But so to me, it's just being in a bit of an unpredictable world where there's always something new that you're trying to grapple with or understand and all of that. So,
yep. So the exact opposite. Yeah. The exact opposite of your fear you shared earlier of, I don't want to leave Big Four and do the same thing every day. You have found something that is not that. You have found what you were looking for.
Exactly. Exactly. In fact, sometimes I laugh. I'm like, maybe a little calmer, a little more boring would be okay every once in a while. But then I think about myself and I'm like, no, I would be a real bore. So it's good. I like the constant change.
That's awesome. Well, one thing, I'd love to look back maybe on your career. Is there anything that you look back on and think these are one of the coolest or most enjoyable or proudest accomplishments in your working life? I guess, you know, is there anything that you look back on and it still makes you smile or light up, and because you're just so proud of what you and your team was able to do? Is there anything that strikes you to that question?
Yeah, and so many things, but I think maybe going back to something we talked about a little earlier is just making CFO. I was at the firm for, let's see, I was there about 2.5 years before I got promoted. And when I saw some paperwork that, not that I wasn't supposed to see, I was eventually going to see it, but it indicated that the promotion was here. And even though they had said to me, yes, your role is that you will track, assuming you track, you will eventually move into CFO. But as many industry jobs are, you don't know the timeline. You don't know, you know, is it 2 years? Is it 10 years, you know, and somewhere in the middle. And so when I saw that, and when eventually I was in disbelief, and then when I met with the partners and they told me, I was just like, I can't believe this is a dream come true. I think no matter how hardworking we are or what success we have, I think there's always a little bit of maybe a feeling of like imposter syndrome, like, oh, well, they could make CFO, but I don't know. Maybe I'm not smart enough. Maybe I didn't, you know, maybe I didn't do this. Maybe I didn't do that. And so just getting there, and particularly getting there in a bit of a male dominated world or industry, has been really exciting, and they're probably my biggest accomplishment.
Yeah.
And it would have been something that if you would have asked me coming out of college, would you ever be a CFO? I probably would have said, no, I can't do that. You know, like I'm a straight A student and I work hard and I study a lot, but no, I couldn't do that. You know, so it's just, it's exciting to see, like, you really can do whatever you put your mind to.
So. Yeah. It's like getting that title was the culmination of almost becoming this person who is capable of these things that maybe you weren't quite sure if you were capable of before. Right.
Absolutely.
And it wasn't some like, I'm going to be a CFO. That's my goal. Yeah. It was more like, oh, wow, this almost represents a transformation of this new person I am that I didn't know if I was capable of being. And now I am.
Absolutely.
That's awesome. Do you remember, out of curiosity, do you remember when you got that paperwork or had that meeting? Like, how did you celebrate that day? What did you do that night? Do you remember?
That night, yes, I'm sure I celebrated. I felt like I was celebrating for a long time, you know, because it was like, I remember texting my best friend and I was like, I think it's going to happen. I think it's going to happen, but I don't even want to say anything because I'm so nervous that I might jinx it, you know? And then, and then it was wonderful because, you know, it was like, then I got to celebrate with my parents. My dad was a CFO for several years. And so, that was exciting as well because he really understands a lot of my day-to-day world. And so he and I constantly kind of nerd out about all the things that you think about in these roles. And so it's exciting for me to have that support and be able to celebrate with him. But yeah, it was right before Christmas. And so it was great because I was with a lot of family. I took some time off and got to really just kind of, okay, this is real.
Yeah, that's awesome. And on another side, do you recall any big kind of fork in the road moments or holy geez moments in your career where maybe they had a big impact on your direction? Maybe you didn't even realize they were fork in the road moments at the time, but maybe looking back, you're kind of like, wow, I'm really glad I handled that way because things would have maybe changed dramatically if I handled it another way. Are there any of these moments, these kind of fork in the road or, oh my gosh, am I gonna recover from this? Are there any of those types of moments that you can recall in your career that you'd like to highlight again that maybe other people can kind of learn from the experience? Because I know I've had some of those, but this is not about me. This is about learning from you, Laura. Like anything there that you can share that others can learn from.
Yeah, well, I think the one thing that I just think about throughout my career is everyone makes mistakes, right? No one's perfect. And I feel pretty lucky because I haven't made any mistakes that have sent me down a totally different path or, you know, put a huge fork in my road. But, you know, the one thing that someone told me when I was very young in my career and had made a mistake that at the time felt like, oh my gosh, maybe this is, you know, this is the end, right? Yeah. In retrospect, very small deal. But at the time they told me, it's not about the mistake you make. It's about how you handle it, how you move forward from it. And what do you learn from it? Because everyone's going to make mistakes. And I constantly tell my team that because that was such a reassuring light bulb moment for me of like, oh gosh, duh, we're all humans. We're not perfect. We're never going to be perfect. And so it's not about perfection. It's about continuing to use an opportunity where you make a mistake, small, big, somewhere in the middle, and say, okay, how can I prevent that from happening again? How can we make sure that that's not going to be the same hiccup that we go through again? So that has been kind of transformational for me across my career. And I always try to think of that when I'm like, that didn't go exactly how I wanted it to, but it's okay. I'm going to look forward and here's how I'm going to do it slightly differently next time.
Yeah. And Maybe you don't recall, or maybe it was too small. You mentioned this was earlier in your career, but do you, out of curiosity, do you recall the mistake and how you owned up to it and kind of moved past it and showed others that, again, you're not going to let one mistake turn into a second, but you're going to own it. You're going to learn from it. Do you recall yeah. how that happened?
Yeah, absolutely. It sounds a little silly now, but I was working in Big Four, and we had a team, an audit team that was based in India. And essentially, you know, our team here in the States, we would work on client deliverables during the day. And then at the end of the day, we would send an email to our team in India. Okay, if you guys can get through X, Y, and Z tonight, then, you know, we'll pick it back up in the morning, et cetera. And so at the time, we must have already filed our audits, and we were going through a process of archiving and, you know, saving down files that we needed, but then expunging others and things like that. And I was the one in charge of sending them the instructions. It's probably 2 years in or something. And it was not hard things to do, but I told them to delete one of the engagements that absolutely should not have been deleted. And it was probably just a manager that came in the next morning. We were, you know, back in the office, and he said, who deleted blah, blah, blah. I cannot find anything. It's not here. And in fact, maybe he probably didn't even say delete it. He was like, what happened to all these files? And I was like, oh, you know, just kind of going around my thing. And then I was like, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
And I literally, it took me probably 10 seconds. And I was like, it was me. I told him to do it. I didn't mean to.
Yeah.
And so, you know, and of course I'm, you know, I'm going to be fired. I told our India team to delete this and the audit's done. And now we have no files and all this stuff. And I just, you know, I kind of just went to him and just said, I'm so sorry, you know, let me know if I need to, like, you know, kind of pull my stuff together and, like, you know, start packing up and leave. And, you know, he was incredibly gracious and just said, you know what, Laura, it happens. Don't worry about it. Thank you for telling me.
Yeah.
And, you know, kind of one of those things is like, okay, well, how do we make sure this doesn't happen again? Well,
yeah,
I probably need to be double checking my work more, have someone else double check my, you know, just things like that. But I just remember being, I told him. So, you know, sometimes honesty is always the best policy, but at least luckily, it wasn't a career ender for me. So,
yeah. And I do want to highlight the way you handled that, of owning it right away. And then even offering, like, do I need to clear out my desk? Like, because here's the thing, like, we all make mistakes, like you said, many. And the type of person, like, you have now many people who, you know, work for you, right? The type of person who owns it in that way and immediately says, I'm sorry, it was me. I just now realized that. I'm so sorry. Like, if you need to let me go, I would understand. Like, the type of person who takes that much ownership of a situation is exactly the type of person who I want on my team, and exactly the type of person who I would have confidence in that they would not do that again. They would learn from it, and they would actively help others not repeat a mistake like that. So it's almost like the way you own, the way you respond to these things often is way more important than what you actually did.
Absolutely. And I could not agree more. It's like, for my team, I tell them all the time, it's okay to make mistakes. Like, we are going to make mistakes.
Yeah.
But again, to your point, it's how we handle them. And I want an environment where people feel safe to raise their hand and say, it was me. So.
Yeah. 100%. Yes. Maybe that was one of them, but there any tougher times in your career, or times where things just fell off, or maybe for 3 months or 6 months or a year, you just kind of feel like, I'm not really firing right now. Something's off. I don't know what it is. And if you ever had that, how'd you get back on track?
Yeah, it's a great question. I feel like I occasionally will have those moments when I get really, really busy in my job.
Yeah.
And I will go through periods of time, and it's say more when I was working in Big Four, but I wouldn't always take care of myself, and I wouldn't prioritize myself and what I needed to really be healthy and taking care of myself. And, you know, I think the thing that I have learned and I continue to continue to try to learn and continue to try to make sure that I'm doing this is, you know, what are those foundational things for you individually that are going to make you a happy person who, you know, is then at a point where you can go to work every day and you can fire on all cylinders and you're, you know, just making sure it's so silly, but it's like making sure you're getting 6 to 7 hours of sleep, making sure that, for me, like that I'm keeping up with my faith life, you know, making sure that I have family in my life, making sure that I'm working out, you know, just all those kind of things that sometimes it's very easy to let them fall off the wayside, particularly when you're drowning in a deadline. But yeah. For me, making sure that those things are always a priority is very helpful in how I execute on all other parts of my life. But I still work. It's still a constant, you know, it's a work in progress to make sure that I'm doing all of those things and still doing great at work. So.
Yeah, it's almost like that movie Inception, like the little token that every individual has to make sure you know you're still in the real world. It's like we all have these different things that are very important to us that kind of keep us grounded.
Exactly.
It's all about finding what those things are, because they typically just bring you back to a better place where you can be thinking better, thinking more clearly, and firing better.
Exactly.
And those ones you found for you might work for a bunch of other people. They might have a couple other things that they really need, but it's all about finding what those things are that work for you. Now a couple more, maybe one more actually career questions, and then we'll get to a wild, fun, crazy question. But are there any things that in your career you have consistently done that you think just work really well for you? And maybe they've helped you get to, again, this CFO role that maybe you questioned if you were going to get to, or you're so proud of because you didn't know if that's where you're going. But are there any things you've consistently done in your career that you think have worked really well? And maybe you're surprised other people don't do those things too, because they seem to work. Anything strike you?
Yeah. A couple things, and they all sound a little small now that I'm thinking about them, but being responsive, I think, is a huge one for me. We always had a kind of a 12 hour, okay, make sure you're responding in 12 hours to any sort of client request when I was at the firm. And for me, I'm always shocked sometimes when I'll email people and it just kind of goes into a black hole. And I will say that I've probably gotten a little laxer over the years about being like, okay, I got to respond immediately, because you can't get buried in emails. But I think just being responsive is one. I touched on relationships earlier, but I think that I can't, you know, overemphasize the power of relationships. And, you know, the other thing for me that always has been very instrumental is just being organized. I think I'm always, not always shocked, but I'm shocked at how some, you know, the lack of organization that individuals have at some points. And I'm, you know, but everyone's got a system, right? For me, I've got my list. It's been very helpful for me to just kind of have that constant list over years and years. And my family all gives me a hard time about it. They're like, how's your list going? I'm like, yeah, you know, there's a lot on there, really, to be honest. But for me, it's just finding your method and finding out what works for you. But for me, it's the way that I don't let things slip through the cracks. Maybe they're not done exactly as quickly as I'd like them, but it's gonna get done eventually.
Couple quick hitter questions. Got a couple more of these as we're looking to kind of wrap some things up here. So, question on your CPA. So when did you knock it out? Was it before you started working, or were you knocking it out while you were working full time? And maybe based on your experience and what you see today, like what would you recommend for folks today of how to approach the CPA exam?
Absolutely. So I took it before I started working.
Okay.
I took it the last semester of my fifth year in school. So it was in the second half of my master's year. And I would highly, highly, highly recommend taking it before you start working, because once you start working, particularly if you go into one of the big firms, you're likely going to be working long hours. It's really tough to work long hours and then go home and try to study, or it's all you're doing on the weekends. So to the extent that you have the ability to to take it before you start working, I would strongly encourage everyone to do that.
Yeah, that's the number one piece of advice I hear is try to knock it out before you start working. And out of curiosity, did you have to sacrifice? I took my whole summer in between college and working to not like any sacrifices that you had to make that at the time were maybe like, do I really want to give this up? That maybe later when you were working, you're like, I'm so glad I gave that up. So any stories of sacrifice there that again, at the time maybe felt, that later you were thankful that you sacrificed that time to be done with it.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I felt like I sacrificed the second semester of my fifth year.
Yeah.
I really stopped. I was always very social and liked to do stuff with girlfriends and all of the things. And I really stopped doing all of that my second semester of my fifth year when I was sitting for the CPA. I had structured it so that I only had maybe two classes that semester. And then I was a teacher's assistant for another class. So call it 9 hours of school. Yeah. So I didn't have much in terms of school, but I was incredibly studious. And so I really took studying for the CPA like a full-time job. So, in a lot of ways, I kind of felt like, oh man, this is my last semester. And I'm telling myself, like, you know, one night a week with your girlfriends. And other than that, you know, you need to have your head down and you need to be studying and focused. But then I'm so grateful that I did that, because once I started work, it's very difficult to work long hours and then come home and study the CPA. So I was very, very glad in retrospect that I put my head down and did it.
Yeah. Awesome. And what's the number one piece of advice that you might give for accounting majors in college today, or maybe it's their first year in the working world? Or maybe said another way, if you were in that position now, knowing what you know today, what advice would you maybe go back and give yourself if you were in your last year of college in accounting or your first year in the working world? So again, you could phrase that as, hey, folks today, or potentially here's the advice I'd give myself. So what's that number one piece of advice that you'd kind of give to folks in that position today?
Yeah, it's a great question. When I was getting my accounting degree and starting my career, I did not feel like there was the emphasis on technology that we have today. And, you know, in so many different ways, right? I mean, now we've, you know, AI and all of the different, you know, abilities and capabilities that we have with AI, but also just like the power of Excel. It sounds really cheesy, but we did not do much at all in Excel when I was in college. And now I live in Excel, and it will save you so much time if you know how to effectively utilize that program. And so I would say just keeping up with the technology and making sure that you're really proficient in Excel is the advice I would have given myself back then.
Yep. And you mentioned AI. How, if at all, are you utilizing AI today? We're recording this here in the third quarter of 2024. And I use that just because this is changing so fast all the time, right? Just curious, how if at all, are you using AI in your work today?
Yeah, we are using it. I would say generally, you know, we've been, because we work with a lot of confidential information, we've been a little slower on some adoption of full-blown programs. I would say, you know, we do use it a lot to take notes during meetings, assign action items, things like that. We've found that it's great with things like that. And then it automatically is saving you time, but there's still the human time that's needed to go through and like, okay, this is the notes that came back, but we need to tweak them and, you know, things like that. And so I do think, you know, it will be a huge time saver in time. We're just kind of figuring out which programs work for us, but.
Yep. Going back to more accounting CPA path, you know, knowing what you know now, would you still go down the same path? Right? Would you still go down the accounting CPA journey that you went down, knowing kind of what you know today? Is that still something that you'd, again, if you could go back 20 years, would you still say yes? And would you still recommend this for others, and why?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great question. I 100% would recommend it. I would do it again. I wouldn't I don't want to say I wouldn't change anything because I'm sure there's something I might change, but generally speaking, I would go the same direction. And I think, you know, it goes back to the advice that I was told when I was young, was that accounting really is the language of business. And so by understanding accounting and the numbers and the impact on a company's bottom line, it's so powerful. And, you know, I think majoring and starting in accounting, you have so many options to branch off into something that's more financial related or something that's maybe, you know, more in operating a business. And there's just so many different offshoots that you can really do that I think it's really an invaluable career and starting point.
Yeah, 100%. It's amazing to me how many people I've spoken with that background in accounting, myself included, who are doing things beyond just a typical accounting path, because with that foundation, I mean, the amount of things that are open to you is really much wider than most people realize. Very quick questions for quick hitters to wrap this up here. One is, hey, is there anything you need of the audience, right? Is there anything you're looking for? Hiring, expertise on a certain topic. It always is fun to ask if people are hiring, and then like, I'm always looking for CPAs. They're hard to find. So is there anything that you're looking for that you need or that you would ask of the audience?
Yeah, it's a great question. Well, good CPAs are hard to find. And so yes, we are always looking for good, smart, talented, hardworking people. And so I would say absolutely, we're always looking. In terms of other requests, I don't think so. You know, I am very passionate about majoring in accounting and all of that. And so I would just say, tell your friends, it's not boring. I do such a small percentage of my job is actually dealing with accounting right now. You know, it's so many more forward-looking projections, things like that, versus accounting is often looking at what did happen. And so I would say, you know, there's just so many options and things you can do with that background.
100%. And is there anything else that you'd like to highlight that you think is valuable, fun, or interesting to share? Or, you know, sometimes it's more like, I have nothing else, but I want to re-highlight, yellow, underline 3 times this one thing that I said, because it's so important. So anything else you want to share, or anything you want to just come back to and restate because you feel so passionately, or you feel it's that important?
Yeah, good question. I feel there's probably several things I would repeat, but, you know, I think I would just encourage everyone to not underestimate the power of relationships. One thing I didn't say earlier, but that's just stuck with me throughout my career is one of the first partners I work with told me that building relationships at every level within your clients is important because, you know, as a staff accountant or auditor, you're interfacing with maybe staff accountants or project accountants, but eventually that project accountant might move up to like an assistant controller, and then that assistant controller could one day be the CFO or the CAO. And I remember him telling me that and thinking, oh, okay, that makes sense. And over my career, it's been really awesome to see that, you know, the people that I was kind of in the trenches with that are now, you know, in places where, you know, they are powerful and they do have, you know, they've moved up in the companies. And so it's just, yeah, I think just making sure that people know you're never too young to start building out those relationships.
Awesome. Relationships absolutely matter 100%, maybe even more so now in a world where we can do these Zoom meetings, but that face-to-face interaction might even maybe be more valuable because it's more rare in today's world.
That's right.
All right, awesome. Laura, thank you so much for doing this. Appreciate it. You definitely have a cool career in accounting, and you love your job. So there's nothing more you can ask for than that. So thanks for spending some time with us, and hope the audience got a great deal learned out of this.
Thanks so much, Spencer. Thanks for listening.